I came to realize by observation, right? I didn't force this. This is something I observed in myself, which is that from 6 a.m. until noon, my brain is very capable, my body is very capable of doing certain things far more easily than at other times of the 24-hour cycle. So I consider that sort of, you know, the first phase of my day. Sometimes I'm up by 6, sometimes it's 7, sometimes it's 8, usually it's about 6, 6:30. So I consider that one opportunity block. The second opportunity block is between noon, or because I eat lunch typically around noon, between, you know, 1 and 6 p.m. or noon and 6 p.m. So a second opportunity block. And then the third is between 6 p.m. and bedtime, which for me typically is 10:30, but sometimes late. I'm half Argentine. Sometimes I go to bed at midnight and I just go, I'll take a nap the next day. I mean, you have to live. I mean, come on. So what I started to realize is that I can do really focused work in two, but not three of those blocks consistently. I also noticed that if I exercise early in the first block, like between 6 a.m. and before 9 a.m., I have more energy all day long. This is what I observed experimentally on myself. But if I exercise starting at 9 or starting at 10, sort of halfway through that block, the second opportunity block is diminished. I'm kind of dragging. Maybe it's related to when I eat, but that wasn't changing when I eat or what I eat. So I do think that people could benefit tremendously, not necessarily by following the schedule that I follow, but by paying attention to their natural cognitive and physical rhythms. And so as a consequence, what I now do is I take a look at the day. Like, for instance, this is afternoon. We sat down together here at 1. I think we're probably somewhere around 2 p.m. I don't know, somewhere around there. But I realized, okay, I could work before I got here in this early day block or this evening. What I chose to do this morning was kind of more procedural things. Took care of some posting for our Monday episode, took care of some phone calls. I took a walk, took care of some email, made sure I ate some food before I came here. On the way here, I did a brief 10-minute NSDR because I didn't sleep quite as much last night as I would have liked, but I walked in feeling great. So I can work two of these three blocks. And then the third one ends up being kind of a mishmash of procedural stuff. So today, the early part of the day, the 6 a.m. to noon block, was kind of like handled doing it's work, but it's not like focused work stuff. And I didn't train today because I trained yesterday. And today was a day off in any case. Hopefully we'll do some sauna cold tonight. So now we're working, I'm focused. And I imagine that, you know, 2, 3, 4 hours of this and my brain will have, you know, expended some pretty serious cognitive effort. And then I'll take a little bit of, I'll expect a sort of dip in energy. I won't force it. And then this evening I'll get some work done and then hopefully we'll do some sauna cold. So I'm very aware of the fact that I get sort of two opportunities from these three blocks. Mm-hmm. Now, my ideal schedule would be to work in the first two blocks really, really hard. Still eat, still train early. So it'd be train early, work in the first block. So get the training done by 8 a.m., no later. Work, super focused work. Then eat something, super focused work in the second block. Maybe do an NSDR to recover my mental and physical vigor. And then in the evening,
Social time,
relax. Three days of pain, the rest is easy. So it takes about 3 days to shift the biological mechanisms to make you a morning person. Now, if you are a very strongly genetically determined night owl.
That's a thing.
So there are genetic mutations, they call them polymorphisms, that make some people night owls. They feel best psychologically and physically going to sleep at about 1, 2, or 3 a.m. and waking up somewhere around, you know, 10, 11 a.m. or noon. Mm-hmm. That exists. Not just during development or teen years, but that exists, not just for social reasons. Other people are true morning people. They feel absolutely best going to sleep around 8 p.m. or 9 p.m. 10 p.m. would be late for them, and they feel great waking up at 4, 5, or 6 a.m. Okay. Most people feel best going to sleep somewhere between 10 and midnight and waking up somewhere between 6 a.m. and 8 a.m. or so, maybe 5:30 to 8 a.m. Okay. So those are three bins of the night owl, the morning person, and then the more typical schedule, but it's heavily weighted toward that typical schedule if you look at the general population. So if somebody wants to get up earlier, you need to stack the four primary what are called Zeitgebers or timekeepers, so named because some of the early chronobiologists that discovered this stuff and the underlying mechanisms were German. as it were. So the number one Zeitgeber, the number one way to shift your circadian clock, which is this cluster of neurons that sits a few centimeters above the roof of your mouth, is to view bright light at a time when you want to be awake, AKA the morning. Okay. So that's why I say, get outside, look at the sun, toward the sun. Don't force yourself to stare at it. Don't damage your eyes. Blink as needed. No sunglasses. Eyeglasses, corrective lenses, and contacts are absolutely fine, even if they have UV protection. Okay. However, if you combine that with another Zeitgeber, the second most powerful Zeitgeber is exercise or movement. So if you do some jumping jacks, you skip some rope, or even just take a walk while facing the sun, now you're starting to stack different Zeitgebers. And I'll explain the mechanisms in a moment. If you then also add caffeine, now this spits in the face a little bit of what I said a few minutes ago, but if you were to add caffeine, you can entrain, as it's called, the circadian clock to be alert at that time a bit more. And I'll be honest, if I'm going to exercise first thing in the morning, I need caffeine. I can't wait that 60 to 90 minutes. If I need to jump right into exercise, I find it's easiest for me to do 30 minutes after waking, 3 hours after waking, or 11 hours after waking. And a lot of people find that the same. But of course, exercise when you can, because it's that important. But if you want to, quote unquote, optimize your energy levels for exercise, typically people will notice that has to do with your temperature rhythm. Okay, so we've got sunlight, we've got exercise or movement of any kind. It could be jumping jacks, could be walking. You don't have to do a full workout. And then caffeine, and in some cases, food. I'm not big on eating first thing in the morning. I don't like to eat until 11 a.m. or noon. That's when my first meal arrives. For me, just naturally, that's when I get hungry. It's all caffeine and hydration prior to that. But if you were to eat something first thing in the morning, that's part of the way you entrain your circadian clock to wake up, to essentially wake you up earlier. And then the fourth one is a social rhythm. If you're interacting with other people, you are going to entrain your clock to that as well.
No way.
Yes. So there's a social component to circadian entrainment. Now, the pathways for these are from the eye, in the case of viewing light, to the circadian clock, the suprachiasmatic nucleus. In the case of caffeine, it's more general. In the case of exercise, there's literally a brainstem to circadian clock connection, a big superhighway of neuronal connections that then so-called entrains your circadian clock. Remember, your circadian clock generates an intrinsic 24-hour rhythm such that if we put you into constant dark or constant light, you would still sleep for a given bout and then be alert for a given bout with a little bit of a nap. It just is what we'd call free run. It would drift a little later each day. This is what happens when you go to Vegas. This is what happens when you're in an environment without a lot of cues about the day, the sunlight rising and setting cycle. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Sunlight, exercise, caffeine and eating, and social interactions bring your circadian clock into alignment with all of those Zeitgebers. So when I said it takes 3 days, if tomorrow you want to start beginning the process of becoming an early riser, you'd set your alarm for 5 a.m. No matter what time you went to sleep the night before, you're going to get up and you're going to do the four things that I described. Maybe leave out food if you don't want to eat. Maybe leave out caffeine if you want to delay by 90 minutes. It's going to hurt. And then by the early afternoon, you'll be dragging a bit. And you just have to be careful to not overindulge in caffeine, which will then cause you to fall asleep later. Then you want to go to sleep at your now naturally slightly earlier sleep time. The next day, you'll notice it'll be a little bit easier to do the morning routine I just described. And by the third day, you ought to be waking up with or before the alarm by a few minutes or moments. Your circadian clock, intrinsic to you, generates a 24.2 or a 24.3 hour rhythm. It's not perfectly 24 hours. And that we believe, we don't know, but the just so story is that it's such that you're able to then shift that clock in one or the other direction. You can phase advance, so you wake up earlier and go to sleep earlier. You can phase delay. How do you phase delay? Well, you're probably doing this already. Everyone nowadays pretty much qualifies as a shift worker by the strict and not so strict criteria of shift work, which is, are you doing any kind of cognitive activity after 9 p.m.? Are you viewing any kind of bright lights after 9:30 p.m.? Most people would say yes. So the diabolical thing about the circadian timing system is that It requires a lot of bright light, ideally from sunlight, but a lot of bright light early in the day to make you a morning and daytime person. Mm-hmm. But it requires just a little bit of bright light, even from an artificial source, after the hours of about 9:30 p.m. till 4 a.m. to quash your melatonin and make it difficult to sleep, or if you sleep, to make that sleep not as effective. There's a simple remedy, however, which is, and this is a beautiful study published in Science Reports in 2022, if you view sunlight in the afternoon, even for 5 minutes or so, could be late afternoon, could be sunset, take off your sunglasses, look in the direction of the sun, so now looking west, you adjust the sensitivity of your retina, the neurons in the back of your eye, such that bright light later at night doesn't have quite as much effect to suppress melatonin. It reduces the melatonin suppressive effects by about 50% or offsets those. So I think of this afternoon viewing as, well, first of all, it's nice to look at a sunset. If you're indoors in an environment like this, even if there are bright lights on, get outside for a few minutes before the sun sets. This is especially important in winter. Even if you can't see the sun as an object, get some sunlight in your eyes, and that will at least partially offset the effects of bright light in your eyes at night, partially. And I refer to this more or less as your Netflix inoculation, so that that night you can be on your phone or watch Netflix and it's not going to disrupt your sleep as much, but it will still disrupt your sleep somewhat. But let's, you know, unless, like, Rick Rubin's very diligent about wearing the red lens glasses. I've started doing that as well. But if you don't do that, I'm guessing he also sees the sunset in the evening. Mm-hmm. He's very attached, for good scientific reasons, to the sunlight thing. But these are little things that take just moments, right? They're essentially zero cost, that can really improve your sleep. But that's how you become a morning person. If you want to become a night person, you do the opposite. You view bright light between the hours of 4 p.m. and 10 p.m. and then you will phase delay or phase shift in a delayed way your circadian clock, making you want to wake up later the next morning.
I wonder if dogs count as social interaction.
Absolutely. And they have all of the same mechanisms we just described.
So I just thinking, can we stack that everything first thing in the morning walk?
Yeah.
If you're in a place that's not Iceland or somewhere that's super high north, social interaction, moving around, and then caffeine if you do or if you don't want it. But
if you have a dog that likes to run, you're even better off, because it'll force you to run.
You're gonna have to chase after it.
If you have an English bulldog like I did, you'd be lucky if you get out of bed by 10.
A little bit. Yeah, you're in
their
gear
eyes
one.
Are droopy. They don't, and they don't like to move. But it is the case that dogs will naturally orient toward the sun. You know, and people always ask, you know, do dogs have the same mechanisms? Absolutely. Intrinsically photosensitive retinal ganglion cells, the one that project to the clock and carry all of this thing about circadian entrainment to sunlight, are present, as far as we know, in every extant mammalian species, every mammalian species that's alive today. And, you know, this is a system that evolved from bacteria that's very similar to the opsins, the light absorbing molecules that are in the insect eye. It's a very primordial system. It's organized very differently anatomically in the retina. And to me, it's actually one of the more beautiful systems in all of us. In fact, the one thing that no one can seem to defeat, you're never going to biohack away, is circadian biology. This, you know, 24-hour fluctuation in energy and focus. You know, some people require less sleep, but We're all more or less a slave to these mechanisms. And, you know, it's a good thing that we are, because it forces us to rest. Neuroplasticity occurs during sleep. They push down adenosine. You know, it takes us through these natural ebbs and cycles of cognition. I'm obsessed by the idea that in sleep, you know, the conscious mind obviously is not in control. The unconscious mind can geyser up thoughts. The brain is organizing things more in terms of symbols. Time and space are very, very organized very differently in dreams. And there's a lot of information to be gleaned from dreams. It's just that we don't yet understand what the symbols mean. The kind of classic Freudian, Jungian interpretations are certainly not going to be complete. But, you know, I'm so grateful that we get this thing called sleep. And I think, thanks to the great Matt Walker, we now understand that the whole thing of "I'll sleep when I'm dead" is a really dumb mindset. And, you know, my team at the Huberman Lab podcast, we sometimes joke that we win by sleeping. You know, when we're in the peak of things, we all encourage each other to, like, get rest, you know, get rest. Like, we really prioritize sleep. It's so essential. Adenosine is an incredibly interesting molecule. It exists in the brain and body. It accumulates with the number of hours that you're awake. So the longer you're awake, the more adenosine accumulates. It does many things in the brain and body. One of the most important things that it does is to give us the subjective experience of feeling sleepy and the objective feeling of our body being fatigued, of feeling literally heavier, requiring more energy to move ourselves. When we sleep and when we allow ourselves to go into states of deep rest that are similar to sleep, we can talk about this, the adenosine system is adjusted so that there's less effective adenosine circulating or bound to adenosine receptors. Okay, so this sort of adenosine 101. There's a lot more to it, but that's sufficient for what we need to talk about for now. The drug, the most commonly used drug, the drug we're using now and that we're on right now, caffeine, which is consumed by, it's estimated more than 90% of the world's adult population, effectively works by blocking the adenosine receptor. There's some nuance there, but we can think of it that way for simplicity's sake. And in doing so, it prevents the sleepiness-inducing actions of adenosine. However, when caffeine wears off, the adenosine that was around trying to bind to those receptors is still around. In fact, it's accumulated even more, which at least partially explains the so-called caffeine crash or the dip in energy, the fatigue that is that we experience maybe 3 or 4 hours after consuming caffeine. Okay. As I mentioned before, when we go to sleep at night, adenosine is cleared from our system. There was a lot of debate over the years about why we sleep. In fact, the great Matt Walker wrote the book, Why We Sleep. And a lot of that has to do with the cell biology of regulating potassium and other ions that are in neurons. And for those that are interested in the cell biology, it's about readjusting the amount of potassium inside and outside the cells, which is happening on an ongoing basis. But you could think of the time that we sleep as doing many things, but one of the most important things is to bring those adenosine levels down. Whatever adenosine has accumulated, to bring it back down such that when we wake up in the morning, we feel alert. Okay, there are a lot of reasons why we feel alert. Some of them we can call pro-alertness mechanisms, like the release of cortisol. Some of them are about removing the brake on wakefulness, like reducing adenosine. Here we're talking about removing the brake on wakefulness by reducing adenosine. So let's say, what time do you go to sleep at night, typically? If you add your way.
10 o'clock.
10 o'clock. And what time do you typically wake up in feeling great with no alarm clock?
6:30, 6:45.
Great. So let's say you go to sleep at 10:30 and you wake up at your usual time. Chances are you will have cleared a lot, but not all the adenosine that's required for you to wake up feeling very alert. Let's say you stay up a little bit later. Maybe you stay up until 11. Maybe you wake up twice that night to use the restroom for whatever reason. You consumed a bit more fluid. Maybe it takes an extra 10 minutes for you to fall back asleep the second time. And then you wake up in the morning and you didn't get the total amount of deep sleep and rapid eye movement sleep that you're used to getting. Without question, your levels of adenosine upon waking are going to be slightly higher than they normally would. Okay, once you understand what adenosine does, you think about that scenario, it's kind of an obvious thing. However, most people don't sleep until they naturally wake up feeling refreshed. Most people are using an alarm clock. Most people are not going to sleep as early as they need to, or sleeping as late as they need to, or both. So as a consequence, when you wake up in the morning, your adenosine levels are not zeroed out to the place where you would be maximally awake. There is a lot of or some residual adenosine present. What do people typically do? Typically, people get out of bed, might look at their phone. As you know, I encourage them to go find sunlight if the sun isn't out, to turn on bright lights and then get outside and get sunlight in their eyes as soon as they can. But chances are they're going to grab some caffeine. They're going to pour themselves a cup of coffee, or they're going to have some, if you're me, yerba mate. They're going to perhaps have an energy drink, all fine and good. But now think about what we just said, which is that what you're doing then is blocking the adenosine receptors effectively. And whatever residual adenosine was there because you didn't sleep enough to clear it out persists. Plus, you're now starting to accumulate more adenosine such that by mid-morning, that adenosine has accumulated, the caffeine has worn off, and maybe by early afternoon, especially after a meal, Many, not all people experience an afternoon crash in energy somewhere between 1 p.m. typically and 4 p.m., somewhere in there. For me, the trough in my natural energy levels in the afternoon is consistently between 2 and 3 p.m., regardless of how well I slept the night before. Many people also find a consistently placed trough in their energy independent of all this. Okay, so what can we do? Some years back, I started suggesting that people consider if they have an afternoon crash in energy, that they delay their morning caffeine intake for 90 minutes after waking. Some years after that, an academic review was published saying, well, there's really no evidence that that specific practice is necessary, but I still think, and I stand by the fact that it can be very useful for those that experience an afternoon crash. Why? Well, two things. First of all, by delaying caffeine for the first 60 to 90 minutes after waking, there's an interesting phenomenon whereby even though you are out of bed and walking around, you're not asleep, if you don't block those adenosine receptors, there's still clearance of adenosine occurring, in part because
it's like residual rest.
You're sort of still asleep.
Wow.
The other thing that works remarkably well to clear out residual adenosine is upon waking, if you don't feel rested enough, to do something I've talked also a lot about, which is another one of these zero-cost tools that has a growing amount of impressive science to support it, which is non-sleep deep rest, or NSDR, also called yoga nidra, which is its proper name. The ancient practice is yoga nidra, so we want to be fair to its proper naming. A 10 or 20 or 30 minute yoga nidra, or NSDR if you prefer, done upon waking, but before getting out of bed, or maybe you go into the living room and put on your headphones or listen to an NSDR script. They're available all over the internet, done by me, done by a woman named Kelly Boys, who has a really lovely voice. If you prefer a woman's voice, it's actually the one I typically use. You will emerge from that feeling much more rested. Now, Dr. Matt Walker himself and I are collaborating on a project to evaluate how NSDR impacts brain states to see if it actually mimics sleep. There's some beautiful studies already published out of Scandinavia showing that longer yoga nidra type practices, non-sleep deep rest, can replenish dopamine stores in an area of the brain called the basal ganglia, which prepares you for mental and physical action. So this is a very well-established tool from the sort of yogic perspective. It's a tool that's gaining increasing scientific evidence. And it, for everybody I know that has tried this, who reports back to me about it, it's a remarkably energetically replenishing exercise that requires no payment, no nothing, just 10, 20, or 30 minute NSDR. Now, what could be happening in that state? In that state, the body is still, the mind is active, which mimics very closely rapid eye movement sleep. So the test that Matt Walker and I are doing, the experiment is to see, is having your body completely still, but your mind active, able to clear adenosine stores in the same way that being deeply asleep is. My guess is that it's not the same, but that it might be a midway effect. That's the hypothesis. We could be wrong. I look forward to seeing the results. So by delaying your caffeine for the first 60 to 90 minutes after waking, but making sure that you hydrate, get your electrolytes, you know, something like Element, which mm-hmm. we both enjoy and make good use of, you are clearing out the adenosine that is residual in your system. Now, why do I also keep harping on this idea of going out and getting bright light in your eyes, ideally sunlight, but if, especially on cloudy days, but if it's not out yet, you can turn on bright lights. Well, when one does that, you actually amplify the naturally occurring peak in cortisol that occurs soon after waking. So about 30 minutes before waking, your cortisol starts to rise. It's part of the mechanism that wakes you up without an alarm clock. As soon as you get out of bed and you start moving around, that cortisol increases further. Your body temperature, by the way, is increasing in parallel. When you view bright light, and these are very well-established studies in humans, as well as animal models, but in humans, when you view bright light, 10,000 lux indoor light if you're using a seasonal affective disorder treatment lamp, or getting outside even on a cloudy day and looking toward the sun, looking east in the morning, without sunglasses, eyeglasses and contacts fine, you induce a near 50% increase in the height of that cortisol peak. That might sound like a bad thing because everyone's stress. Afraid of cortisol, but that's not a bad thing. It prepares your day, prepares you for a day where your immune system is bolstered, your energy and alertness is bolstered, and your ability to learn and your mood, I maybe said mood twice, forgive me, it are bolstered. And in addition to that, there are interactions between light and the adenosine system. light impacts the functional availability of the adenosine receptor in very interesting ways. Light increases, bright light that is, viewed by the eyes, increases the height of that cortisol peak, and then the cortisol peak also helps to counteract the adenosine system. Now, in addition to that, when you get sleepy at night, part of that effect is due to the increase in melatonin, which is released from the pineal gland, a pea-sized gland midway, sort of deep in the vestiges of your brain. When you view bright light at night or during the day, and especially in the morning, it quashes those melatonin levels. So when you wake up in the morning and you haven't slept enough, or even if you have, your adenosine levels are still not to zero, your melatonin levels are still not to zero, and your cortisol is rising. So you've got a pro-wakefulness system, cortisol, that you can accelerate or amplify, rather, by viewing bright light. You've got a anti-wakefulness system in the form of melatonin and adenosine that are pushing back on your wakefulness. You're in this kind of like grogginess, and you can further suppress those systems without caffeine by viewing bright light. So viewing bright light both increases the pro-wakefulness systems in the brain and body and suppresses the anti-wakefulness systems in the brain and body, both in pushing down on the accelerator of wakefulness and mood and alertness and reducing the brake, right? Otherwise, you're sort of trying to drive with the emergency brake on. Then, if 60 to 90 minutes later, you ingest caffeine, now you're blocking the adenosine receptor. Sure, that's fine. I love caffeine. I certainly drink a lot of caffeine and enjoy it for all its effects. And you're now in a position where the arc of your wakefulness is going to be in nice concert with the also increase in adenosine that's naturally going to accumulate throughout the day. And again, there's no requirement to delay your caffeine 60 to 90 minutes after waking, but for people that experience a marked afternoon crash, it's an incredibly effective way to offset partially or eliminate that afternoon crash. He wrote, "I alternate between periods of two different states that vary from a few weeks to a couple of months. I have extremely high motivation in one state where I can do multiple things, side projects, making music, as well as my main things, or really low motivational states where I can barely do anything and I only look for short-term entertainment." I'm guessing short-term entertainment comes in the form of video games, social media, and just kind of doing generally unproductive things, as we all do from time to time. He goes on to write, "What would be the best set of protocols to normalize those extremes into a more stable and consistent state?" Well, first off, this is an excellent question. I say that because it's a question that I hear a lot, and I think that many people are interested in knowing how motivated they ought to feel, and I think a lot of people also feel a lot less motivated than they would like. Now, here the question was specifically about how to not go from these extremes of days or weeks of high motivation to days or weeks of low motivation. But before we do that, we need to take a step back and acknowledge that just as with anxiety or happiness or sadness, we as human beings don't have an objective window into how other people experience motivation. In fact, most of the time we don't even realize how we experience motivation. We just know whether or not we feel a high barrier or a low barrier to leaning into work and getting things done. In fact, I have a good friend who did many years in the special operations community and then went on to the finance community and then now works in health and wellness community. He has a great kind of mental image for all of us to adopt. It's certainly one that I've adopted, which is for anything in our life, we can either be back on our heels, flat-footed, or forward center of mass. Back on our heels meaning really struggling, flat-footed meaning and we're doing okay, or forward center of mass meaning that we feel as if we're really tackling things and that we are in control of our environment, or at least to some degree. You know, so I place that imagery in your mind because I'll return to it a little bit later in the question when we get into some of the underlying circuitry and tools. In the meantime, I want to remind everybody what the basis of motivation is. Now, there are many neurochemicals and neural circuits involved in what we call motivation, but a central theme of the neuroscience of motivation is that the neuromodulator dopamine is involved. Now, dopamine does other things besides control motivation. In fact, it controls light adaptation in the retina, that is your eye. It controls a number of different things in terms of movement. It controls all sorts of things, but It is strongly related to the motivation pathways. How do we know that? Well, there are experiments on animals and humans which show that even in the absence of dopamine, or in the presence of very low dopamine, I should say, people and animals can still experience pleasure. However, when dopamine levels are too low, people's ability to pursue pleasure, or their willingness to pursue pleasure, in particular, their willingness to undergo effort to pursue pleasure, or any goal of any kind, not just pleasure, any goal of any kind, is strongly regulated by the levels of dopamine. So if dopamine levels are too low, people simply will not put in the effort to obtain or reach a goal. If dopamine levels are adequately high, they will put in that effort. And if dopamine levels go too high, you actually see something that is pathologic, which is that people consider every goal a reasonable goal. This is often seen in the manic phase of a manic bipolar person. So for instance, somebody with manic bipolar who's in a manic episode, dopamine levels are very, very high, and they will think every idea is a great idea, and they will have tons of energy to do that, so much so that they're not sleeping. So obviously that's not what we want. What we want, and what the question asker, Martin, is asking about, is how to keep dopamine levels in a range that allow us to lean into effort, but that we don't expend our ability to stay motivated. And we can really trace that back to a biochemical / neural circuit statement, which is, we really want to control our output of dopamine and the baseline levels of dopamine from which that output is taken. In other words, we want to think about dopamine as a reservoir, or residing in a reservoir. That reservoir can be depleted, so it's exhaustible, it's depletable, but it's renewable as well. To pursue a goal, really, really go forward center of mass for many, many hours, or many, many days in some cases, and pursue a goal or multiple goals, and you're really driven to do a ton, what you're effectively doing is generating waves in that wave pool. And if those waves are too big, well, then the waves can't keep repeating themselves. So think about the wave as the motivation and the depth of the pool as the reservoir of dopamine. And if those waves are too big, too much excitement, too much motivation, too much center of mass for a given period of time, then the water in this wave pool sloshes out of the wave pool, lowering the reservoir. And then there are really three ways that you can replenish that reservoir. And you want to maintain or replenish that reservoir if it's been depleted. How do you do that? Well, first of all, quality sleep. So when I say quality, I mean where you're getting enough slow wave sleep and rapid eye movement sleep. So for some people, 6 hours, for some people, 8 hours. Some people might even need a little bit more or a little bit less. We have episodes, the Perfect Your Sleep episode, the Master Your Sleep episode. We have a toolkit for sleep, all available at zero cost at HubermanLab.com, links, etc. So check those out for getting your sleep right. But sleep is really when you replenish that reservoir of dopamine. So you cannot ignore sleep. I'll come back to this in a moment. The second science-supported tool that's really been shown to replenish dopamine, in particular, dopamine within the pathways that regulate motivation, is a practice I've talked about before on the podcast called non-sleep deep rest, sometimes called yoga nidra, although yoga nidra is a little bit different. There are two studies out of Denmark that have explored yoga nidra in the context of dopamine. The first one simply involved having people do a yoga nidra practice. Again, this doesn't involve any movement, but it involves people, potentially you, doing anywhere from 30 to 60 minutes, although there are now data showing that as short as 10 minutes of a non-sleep deep rest, aka yoga nidra protocol, leads to dramatic, really dramatic increases in striatal dopamine reserves. So it essentially is replenishing the dopamine reserve pool. This is why I'm such a fan of using NSDR, aka yoga nidra, at least once a day, and especially under times when you're engaging in a lot of high output. And when I say especially at times when you're engaging in a lot of high output, this is a mistake many people make. They push, 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 push. They're in pursuit of a goal. Then they hit that point where they're exhausted. Then they start doing all the dopamine reserve pool replenishing tools, such as yoga nidra or NSDR. The real key is to always tap off that or refill that reservoir once a day before it's completely depleted. Now, this gets into some of the biochemistry of dopamine and the relevant circuits, but it takes a lot longer to restore the dopamine reservoir think of it still as a wave pool, but that reservoir from a place of complete depletion than it does of partial depletion. So there's an asymmetry in the way this is done. So it's not as if, you know, you drink a glass of water, you fill the glass of water at a certain rate and it fills up to a certain level and the rate is constant. Think about it as once the level of dopamine in your reserve is depleted past a certain point, it takes a lot more effort, much more sleep, much more NSDR, things of that sort, to replenish that reservoir. Now, oftentimes what people will do when they start feeling less motivation is they will start relying on things like Adderall, Ritalin, some cases illegal substances that can increase dopamine. You know what those are. Please don't ever lean to those. They are extremely dangerous. They really are, because of their ability to potently release dopamine. And guess what? Deplete that reservoir even further. Many people think NSDR or yoga nidra are simply meditation with a body scan. That's not true. Meditation is a focus exercise. Okay? Most meditations are focus exercise. NSDR restores energy through the dopamine system, and newer data are starting to show that it can actually recover lost sleep, so if you're not sleeping enough. But to return to NSDR, aka yoga nidra as a practice, yes, it's been shown in laboratory studies in humans, by the way, to restore dopamine levels. There's another study, lesser known, from that same group that was published in 2011, which is entitled Dopaminergic Stimulation Enhances Confidence and Accuracy in Seeing Rapidly Presented Words. This was a cognitive task. They explored yoga nidra, aka NSDR, in the context of increasing striatal dopamine. They already knew that it did that, so that's great. They confirmed that result. But what they also found is that doing NSDR could restore confidence in cognitive ability and performance in these cognitive tasks. Okay, so this is a really powerful zero-cost tool for re-upping or replenishing that dopamine reserve. Okay, so this is something to do every day, especially when you're not feeling depleted. So the question again was about how to make sure that you don't go through these cycles of extreme motivation and then lesser motivation. Well, get your sleep right. I would say 80% or more of the nights of your life. Hopefully the nights that it's not good are for good reasons, that you're enjoying yourself, but hey, life happens. So, you know, 100% of the time is just not reasonable to expect of yourself. Do NSDR once a day for either 10 minutes. If you have the time to do 20, 30 minutes or an hour, you will see even more positive effects. It has been shown in these research studies to replenish dopamine, levels of confidence, cognitive ability, etc., and sense of motivation. And I said there were three tools. And the third tool that really can allow you to keep the dopamine, aka motivation circuitry, tuned up properly is to really start paying attention to peaks in dopamine and be very careful about layering in too many things that can stimulate the dopamine system. I talked about this quite a bit in the episode that we did on ADHD and building and maintaining focus. There are many things out there nowadays that will deplete the dopamine system. For instance, and by the way, none of what I'm about to list is necessarily bad. I actually use some of these things. For instance, caffeine will increase dopamine receptors that will allow whatever dopamine is available to be more potent. Okay, so caffeine's great for some people, less good for people with anxiety. Don't drink it too late in the day because it'll interfere with your sleep, and so on and so forth. But many people will combine caffeine with music that they particularly like. Music's great. Music can stimulate dopamine release. We know this. It can enhance motivation, especially if it's the kind of music that really puts you in the groove for the particular type of work you're going to do. For me, I like to listen to either loud, fast music or Glenn Gould classical piano. So one or the other. I know what's right for me for a given time. You'll know what's right for you for a given time and your preferences. But what will happen is people will start consuming caffeine at higher and higher levels. Again, caffeine isn't necessarily bad, but they'll start doing that and they'll start layering it in or stacking very potent music, potent for them, plus things like L-tyrosine. Again, none of these things are terrible on their own. In fact, they can be very beneficial. Sometimes they'll start taking mecunopurine. Sometimes they'll start relying on things like Adderall, Ritalin. And pretty soon what's happening is they're getting these big waves in that dopamine wave pool, big peaks. And within a few days, or maybe even within a few hours, they're depleted and they're at that low. And then as Dr. Anna Lemke, who was a guest on the podcast, talked about in terms of addiction, but also in her wonderful book, Dopamine Nation, what happens is after those big peaks in dopamine, the reservoir, the baseline in dopamine, drops below its initial level. So it's as if the reservoir got deeper and it's emptier and it takes much, much longer to fill. Okay, so to be quite specific, what I'm recommending is get your sleep right, ideally every night of your life, but for as many nights of your life as possible. That's clearly replenishing dopamine and sense of motivation. Do all the things associated with that: morning sunlight, lack of artificial light at certain hours of the night, etc. All of that's in the toolkit for sleep and other episodes I mentioned before. Have a practice that is research supported to replenish dopamine, and incorporate that practice any time of day. Again, NSDR can be done morning, afternoon, or evening, or middle of the night if you wake up and you need to get back to sleep. It can be very beneficial for that. But do it as a consistent practice so that dopamine reservoir remains tapped off. And as a third point, please be wary of, or at least aware of, these peaks in dopamine and the fact that layering in a lot of things that stimulate dopamine, while that can be wonderful for your wedding, a birth of a new child, going to a sports event with a bunch of friends, celebrating a big anniversary, yes, please do celebrate and enjoy the wonderful events of life. But please also understand and expect there will be a lull, a sort of postpartum low, maybe not full-blown depression, that follows that, unless you incorporate some tools and practices to replenish that dopamine. Does that mean you should never combine caffeine, L-tyrosine, music, and a workout and time with friends? No, absolutely not. But don't expect to do that and then go do an intense bout of work and then get up the next morning and do it all over again for more than a few days before you find yourself pretty depleted. Rather than give you a specific schedule of, you know, do 7 days of this and 4 days of this, what I encourage you to do is for at least 5 days a week, maybe give yourself some time off on the weekends, maybe not, but if for at least 5 days a week, get into a consistent routine that is, I should say, neurobiologically consistent as well with how the dopamine, aka circuits that control motivation, work. And I assure you that you will find yourself in a more regular groove of focus and attention and alertness and motivation when you need to. And provided you're doing all the things I described, and hopefully paying attention to other things like nutrition and social connection too, of course, you'll find a much more even pattern of motivation over time. One last thing before I conclude the answer to this question. When I was in graduate school, I got some wonderful advice from an excellent neurologist. His name is Robert Knight. He used to be at University of California, Berkeley. I think he's retired now, but is still active in the scientific community. And I asked him what he was doing that weekend. I don't know why this came up. And he said, oh, I'm going fishing. I like kind of, you know, mindless recreation. I said, that's great. You know, fishing's fun. I'm not particularly into fishing myself, but I've done it a few times and I enjoy it. And he said, you know, the most important thing for a science or medicine career or any demanding career? I said, what? Like, I was all ears. I was super, you know, super hungry to get in the mix and, you know, do research and publish papers. And he said, figure out how many hours a day you can do real work consistently. That means 5 days a week. For some people, six or seven, but 5 days a week, I think for most people, is going to be a bit healthier overall for your social life and family, etc. And he said, figure that out and know that that number is what you should apply over and over and over again, but update that number about every 4 or 5 years. And I said, okay, so does that mean that over time I'm working more and more or less and less? And he said, ah, here's the deal. As you get better at your profession, you will find that you can do more potent work, more directed work in a shorter amount of time, but that does not mean that you can continue to expand the amount of time that you're doing focused work. In fact, the opposite. So this follows a sort of general principle that's also present in resistance training, you know, weightlifting, right? The analogy there is that people always imagine that as you get better and better at resistance training, that you should do more and more volume, just keep adding volume. And, you know, there's some evidence to support that, more volume for hypertrophy as opposed to less, et cetera. We've done episodes on this. However, there's a different school of thought that works exceedingly well, and it runs in the exact opposite direction, which is as you get better at controlling muscular contractions, or let's say for in an endurance sport, as you get better at regulating your stride and breathing and all those things, you actually can do more, quote unquote, adaptation stimulating damage during a given training session. So you want to train less, not more, over time, because beginners don't actually have the ability to get much done in a lot of time or a short period of time, whereas experts can come in there and really nail it. So I think that advice that Robert Knight was really key, and it's something that I've followed throughout my career. So it one period of my life, I won't mention the hours that I worked in graduate school. They were pretty insane, to be honest. I had family members get a little concerned. I actually lived in the laboratory, even as a junior professor. I don't suggest people do that, by the way, but I enjoyed it at the time. And the key thing is that you figure out what you can do consistently and still maintain mental health and physical health. That's key as well. And do that. And then every couple of years or so, update that, typically by reducing the total amount of time that you're doing that high potency work. I think that combined with the other tools that I described before for generating ongoing dopaminergic circuits, keeping that reservoir full, ought to give you consistent motivation. Again, it's an art and a practice and a science, so don't expect to get it perfect the first time around. Something happened in like the last 8-9 months where I feel hyper-focused on the present. Very, very little focus on the past. Very little. I have exquisite memory of the past, but very little. In fact, one of my journal entries was, I was trying to think of, and this is somewhat embarrassing because it's not the way I would have scripted it, but I was thinking about from the time, as early back as I could remember, the different animals that I felt like I sort of related to or embodied it. You know, when I was a kid, I had the same voice I have now. They called me Froggy, you know, because I was like the kid from The Little Rascals, is a show that most people now don't know. He'd like the kid talk like this. And I had, you know, my Adam's apple was out when I was a little kid. I had hair on my Adam's apple. It's like, I'm a heterozygote for a certain genetic mutation. I overproduce androgen from my adrenals. If you have two copies, it can make you infertile. Fortunately, I don't. I have one copy, and it doesn't result in any other like bodily differences or anything like that. I'm very fortunate in that way, and I'm aware I can reproduce. Let's just leave it at that. Okay. So, but then, you know, there were different animals at different stages of my life as I grew and matured and experienced different things. I was like, at one stage of my life, I felt very oriented towards the mustelids. And then at other times towards like a certain species of cat. And like, I identified with them in a number of ways. And then recently I was on this long run. I do these long Sunday rucks and runs. And I was thinking to myself, like, where am I at right now? And all of a sudden I just went, oh shit, this is about the least exciting animal I could think about. And I realized, like, right now at this stage of my life, I don't know how long this will last. And this is very personal, but whatever. F it. Like, lately I'm just kind of opening up on podcasts, my own and others. I realized, and no, it has nothing to do with butterflies. I realize I'm in total caterpillar mode, and it has nothing to do with becoming a butterfly. Not that that would be a bad thing. It's that I'm able to orient towards the tasks of the day divided into three parts. I basically have vision about this far in front of me, despite what I said a few minutes ago. I can think about what I need to do. I know where I'm headed. I can move forward, not backward, but I can't seem to bring my thinking any further than that. And it's such a new place for me. I have to consciously try and think into the past. I'm like, that was yesterday. It was yesterday. I can't do it. Now, I'm not in denial. I can do it if I need to. But for me, this is a very functional way to be at this point in my life because of the enormous number of tasks in my life. Fortunately, the enormous number of people that I love and that I want to spend time with and make time for. But somehow I have just like, so I drew it out. I was like, I'm freaking caterpillar, you know, and we'll see what happens. And you know, and where this goes, but you know, the other animals in here, there was a rhinoceros phase that was interesting, moving very slowly, but with a lot of force, you know, on anything that was in my way at one stage. You know, there's been times when I've felt like a raptor where I was just kind of like placed and really observant. I spent an entire year speaking very little, believe it or not. People in my life will be like, what year was that? I didn't talk to you that year. Exactly. You didn't talk to me that year and I didn't talk to you. If you're wondering where I was. So right now, by sort of like identifying with this kind of mode of caterpillar vision and movement, everything is in small increments. You know, I even feel it in the way that I talk and the way I parse ideas. I'm writing the bonus chapters for my book, which comes out in April of next year. Like, everything is line by line. Everything is iterative. And I am not oriented toward the past. It's there if I need it. It's like a book on a shelf I can go grab and look things up. But until now have existed very much in like sort of thinking about the losses of past, the wins of past, identifying with that. And I don't know what caused this. I can't point to one single psychedelic journey. Not that I've been doing a lot of psychedelics. We could talk about that. I was involved in some psychedelic trials, but I don't think that's it. I think it's that I've matured. I think the brain matures your whole life. I don't think we have childhood and adulthood and then death. I think we have a developmental arc that starts when we're born, probably before we're born. I mean, after all, you know, we were embryos with, who knows if we have consciousness, but we were alive, right? Born, and then we have a developmental arc. And the great psychologist Erickson talked about at every stage of life from birth until death, until one's 80s and 90s, you're working out some core conflicts of agency versus, you know, autonomy versus having to do what other people have you do. And you know, I forget the stages off the top of my head because it's not my area of expertise. But look at my dad, who's turning 81 in November, who fortunately, you know, God willing, is going to live another 20, 25 years with immense vigor. And he's still cognitively super sharp. And he's working out whatever it is you work out when you're 80.
Yep.
I'm working out whatever it is now, but right now it's like caterpillar vision. And as a consequence, the past, while important and informs a lot of who I am and what I do, it's like, it's not like, it's not in my consciousness at all. And I must say, it's a great place to be, because throughout my 30s, I felt very stricken, very like pulled in different directions based on past, present, and efforts toward the future. So if anyone's, I say this in part because if you're, struggling, like kind of feeling stuck in your life story, there's great advantage to just letting some time pass.
Getting older.
Just getting older is the best. As long as you train with weights 3 times a week, run 3 times a week, long, medium, and short, it runs, and you take a cold shower and you eat mostly unprocessed and minimally processed foods and you try and get sleep and you limit your alcohol and you deal with any addictions you might have and you work on your traumas, like you're gonna have a great freaking life, you know? You're going to be healthier than 90% of people in the world. I'm blessed to have a huge network, but I'll say this. I have that network because I put work into that network. Yeah, some of these people I work with, but you know, Jim Thebeau didn't show up at my house because I'm a podcaster. He showed up there the same way he did 2 years before when I got slammed to the concrete in life. He showed up when I was 14 and I was a depressed kid sitting at the Embarcadero with a busted foot because I couldn't skateboard, and he just sat with me and gave me a book to read and encouraged me to write. You know, I took what Jim did for me and did it for other people. So I like to think perhaps it was God kind of returning the energy, returning the favor. You know, people, you build your support system in good times, and when they're down, you support them, and you don't do it because you might hit bad times. You will hit bad times, and that's one reason to do it. You just do it. And so there's that. So if you're up, build your support network. Doesn't have to be huge, but make it strong. Make it strong by doing the right thing, setting examples, and you know, if it's medium, fine. If it's huge, fine. I definitely use tools, right? The physiological side works to limit stress, get sleep. I didn't rely on pharmacology to get sleep. I know some people need to. I just didn't want to go that route. Once, months earlier, I took a little, it was prescribed to me. I took a half Xanax to try and sleep, and the sleep I got felt like crap. I woke up, I was like, I'm not doing that again. I use breathing tools, I use NSDR, I use some supplementation to sleep. But sleep is key. You win by sleeping. That was one of our mottos during that time and all times. When we're out on the road doing lives, it's like we're going from one city to the next, and we're podcasting and we're doing AMAs and we're busy and we're talking all day and go. Like we're sleeping and we don't drink and we're serious. We're like professional athletes, right? So there's that.
Training. Hot, cold?
Definitely did some hot, cold. In really stressful times, I'll pare back on training a bit. I train as preparation. So for me, lifting 3 times a week, I love training. Yeah, I do my legs, I do my torso, I do my arms and calves and neck. Okay, sure. I do my long run, I do my medium run, I do my sprint day, I do the cold and heat. But I do that not as a means, I do that in part as a means to an end, so that when it's time to sprint for the airplane, when it's time to take a week and just lean all your physical and mental energy into a crisis, You can do that. And then I go back to training.
That would have been, I think I would have struggled. I think I would have struggled to regulate without training each day.
Listen, taking a walk, getting a good shower, getting your hair cut, you know, these things make a difference. The other thing is I learned to be able to call on people, to pick up the phone, you know, and say, hey, listen, like I'm spinning here. I can't make sense of this strategy or that strategy. What do you think? And then writing down what that person said, taking a few things, and then just going inward, right? There is this tendency, especially with text, to constantly be, you know, increasing the size of your committee. I'll say this was interesting. Some people came to me immediately and said, you should do blank. And I was like, really? And they're like, absolutely, do blank. And then I didn't do blank. And then a week later, they're like, oh, you absolutely did the right thing. You should do exactly the opposite of blank. And then I realized, I was like, oh goodness, you know, like, not that I'm never going to listen to advice from that person again, but they were just saying stuff. So you need to be a selective filter, and it can be very hard. And I will say, anyone going through a crisis of any kind, you need a committee, however big or small. And if you don't have people, you need people in books, you need people in podcasts. And, you know, I'm not a recruiter, but you might give prayer a try, because there's real peace at the center there. And from that peace, you can see the right decision. And from that right decision, you can make the right decision for that circumstance.